Hello student, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Ajit Jaiswal from Department of Anthropology, Pondicherry Central University, Puducherry. Today we are going to discuss about a module entitled Forensic Anthropology under paper Physical and Biological Anthropology. Before starting this module, let me give you the important points that we are going to discuss about this module. Like, what is forensic anthropology? What are the different types of evidences related to skeletal explanations, importance of skeleton in personal identification, importance of blood in personal identifications, and what is the role played by fingerprint in personal identification. We also try to highlight the importance of DNA in the context of personal identification. Before proceeding towards discussing about this particular topic, let me give you a glimpse of information as an introduction to this particular topic. As we all know that forensic anthropology is the application of technique of science to legal matter, both criminal and civil matter. Forensic science include a number of disciplines and subdisciplines such as forensic anthropology, forensic engineering, forensic medicine, forensic ecology, forensic pathology, and even forensic chemistry. Forensic anthropology is the application of knowledge and technique of physical anthropology to the study of questions related to medico-legal importance. According to Hawk and Segal, forensic anthropology is the application of the study of women to situation of modern legal or public concern. The objective of this forensic anthropology is to assist in the identification of human remains and personal identification, including age, sex, ethnicity, stature, unique feature, and so on. Many others are there. There are different types of evidences, including skeleton, body fluid like blood, fingerprint, etc., that can be found in a crime scene and are used by forensic anthropologists for personal identification. Now let me give you a small clue. Let's take a skeleton as a forensic evidence. It is easy to identify a skull if we get the complete skeleton. Bones as a part of the complete skeleton are individual intact bones. We can easily find out because it's more or less from the physical or anatomical appearance, we can say that. But becomes problematic if the bones is fragmented, because things such as plastic or piece of tree may also look like bones, and thus it may create confusion. So unlike readily identifiable human bone, in different bones and especially for fragmented bones, the key question over here is that whether it is a bone or not. Next, a forensic anthropology try to answer a number of questions related to that. First important thing, that whether the bone belongs to human beings or not. Is it belongs to human being or some other animal? Are the bones belongs to one person or more than one person? Are the bone belongs to male or female? What was the age at the time of death? What about the sex of the bones? What is the race? So these are the questions that we try to highlight and try to find out when we get a skeletal remains. The answer to these questions are very important, because this will lead to the personal identification of the remains and possible to determine the cause and even manner and many other evidences related to death. We may create a complete picture also. Now let's try to find out whether the particular material that we have recovered, discovered or find is a bone or not. Is it a bone or not? The presence of cortex or outer layer, which what you call it cortex, and the conchylus, the spongy interior or inner part tissue, that differentiate bone from other material. Let's try to find out the answer of this question. Is it human? Skull with rounded vault and flat face indicate that it is a human skull, or randomly scattered osteons in conchylus tissue is indicative of human bone, or dentition and store feature of the teeth like filling or caps also indicate that they are of human. Even the precipitation test also used for identifying as two species. Now let's try to find out the answer of next important question, is that how long since death? It is very difficult to determine the time since death because number of factors including temperature, soil type, whether preserved in a coffin or not, etc., affect the decomposition rate of a body. So, the presence of flesh and odor are good indicator of the recent death. Recent bones which will have a greasy feel, whereas the older bones will be lightweight and have a weakened surface or ends. Severe tooth wear and erosion into the dentition is indicative of ancient remains. Now let's try to find out the answer of next very important question, is that what is the race or ancestry? It is very difficult to ascertain race or ancestry from skeletal remains because no pure race exists today. However, forensic anthropology are routinely called to assess the skeletal remains based on clues as to that person. Their ancestral affinities to help investigator for some, they will give you not very clear picture, but they will give you some glimpse of information that may be additive for personal identification. So let's try to give you some generalized information regarding the racial classifications of the skull, especially between mongoloid, caucasoid and negroid. As the skull length of the mongoloids were comparatively longer than the caucasoid, similarly the negroid also were longer than the caucasoid. So, the skull length of the mongoloid as well as negroids were found to be long in comparison to the caucasoid. If we talk about the skull breadth of the mongoloid and caucasoids were broader compared to the negroids, whose skull breadth were found to be little bit narrower in a comparative context. If we talk about the skull height of the caucasoid, see the differences over here. The skull height of the caucasoids were higher in comparison to mongoloid and negroid. If you compare, if you try to arrange them in a sequential order, the skull height of the caucasoids were higher, followed by mongoloid and then negroid. Similarly, the sagittal contour. The sagittal contours were arched in mongoloid. Similarly, you will find in the caucasoid also, but in the case of negroid, it was found to be flat. If we talk about the face breadth and face height, it is very wide and high in the case of mongoloid, but in the case of caucasoid, it is either wide or high. But in the case of negroid, we find it totally different, it is narrow and low. Similarly, we will find a similar kind of differences in the case of nasal opening and nasal bone. The nasal openings were narrow in the mongoloid, it is moderate widely in the caucasoid, and it is wide in the negroid. Whereas the nasal bone, it is wide and flat, followed by narrow arch and narrower. If we discuss the facial profile, it is straight in almost both the cases except the negroid cases. Whereas the palate shape is U-shaped in except caucasoid, which is V-shaped, otherwise in all the two groups it is U-shaped. So general form, it is supposed to be large and smooth, round and large, and smooth and elongated. Now let's try to find out the answer above of what is sex. Several element of the skeleton can be used by physical anthropologists for determination of sex in an adult, but the pelvis and skulls are the most reliable element for determination of sex. For example, the skull has many features that vary in the two sexes, like the supraorbital ridges are called ridge above the eye. In the case of male, it is robust, while in the case of female, it is gracile. Similarly, the occipital protuberances, that is the base of the skull, in the case of male, it is robust, again gracile in the case of female. The mastoid process, what is called bony process behind ear canal, it is long and broad in the case of male, whereas in the case of female, it is short. Chin in the case of male is U-shaped and square, whereas in the case of female it is V-shaped. See the figure, it shows the figure of human skull of male and female. We can clearly see the differences in the supraorbital ridges occipital protuberances, mastoid process and chin regions. As the supraorbital ridges and occipital protuberances of male were robust and the mastoid process was found to be long and broad in comparison to the female. Similarly, the chin of the male is squarish and U-shaped, whereas in the case of female is V-shaped. Similarly, the supraorbital ridges and occipital protuberances of females were gracile in nature. We can see the small mastoid process and large mastoid process. The difference is that in the case of male it is larger and the case of female it is comparatively smaller. There is a smooth, more vertical frontal bone in the case of female, but it is not so in the case of male. We can easily remark the brow ridges, which is present in the case of male, but absent in the case of a female. The pelvis has many features that vary in the two sexes, that is in the case of male and female. As the symphysis of the pelvis is high and narrow, in the female it is low and wide. Subpubic angle in the case of male is V-shaped, whereas in the case of female it is U-shaped and round. Obturate foramen, it is large and ovoid in male, but it is triangular in female. Sciatic notch is narrow and deep in the male, but it is wide and 70 to 90 degree in female. Then sacroiliac articulation is very large and straight in male, where it is small and oblique in female. Ilium is high and vertical, where it is wide in female. Sacrum in the case of male is long, narrow and straight, but in the case of female it is short, broad and curved. Pelvic inlet is heart-shaped in male, where it is circular, elliptic in female. Acetabulum is large in the case of male, but it is comparatively smaller in the case of a female. See the figure of human pelvic of male and female, and we can clearly see the differences in symphysis, subpubic angle, obturate foramen, sciatic notch, sacroiliac articulation, ilium, sacrum, pelvis inlet and acetabulum. We can see the acetabulum is comparatively larger in the case of male, where it is in the case of female it is smaller. The pelvic inlet is found to be seen to be is it is heart shape in male, but if you see compare it with the female, it is somewhat circular or elliptical. Similarly, the ilium is high and vertical in the case of male, whereas the female pelvis showed that the pelvis is somewhat wide. Similarly, obturator foramen, it is large and ovoid in the pelvis of male, but in the case of female, the pelvis of female, it is somewhat look like a triangular. The subpubic angle, very important one, it shows that it is V-shaped we have seen in the case of male, but it is somewhat U-shaped in the case of a female. So from these traits we can clearly make the differences in the sexes of male and female, and if you find the pelvis of the any of the sexes, that is male or female, we can clearly find out the pelvis belongs to either male or female based on this comparative characteristics. Now once again try to find out the answer of one of the very important questions as far as the personal identification concerned. Or try to find out the solutions of some of the skeletal remains or the material that we discovered from different places. The question is that what is the age of the material that we have discovered? How to find out the age or how old the skeletal material's age is there? So there are no skeletal features that allow us a specific age of the specimen, such as 30 year of age or so many. How we can say that what is your age? We can clearly find out the age by the verbal discussion itself. But here in the case of skeletal remains or skeletal explanation, we have to depend on some of the methods, some of the technique based on that we can determine age. So age determination can be done with a range, for example, 45 to 47 or 60 plus something. It is very difficult to get the exact age, but some average age we can calculate with the help of some estimation method, like estimation of age from sutures of the skull. There is a periodic age bound fusion of the sutures take place, and based on that to some extent we can find out the estimate the age of the skull or age of the bones. closure of suture give us an idea about the approximate age of the specimen. For example, the presence of large frontonellae and wide open sutures in a skull indicate that it belongs to an infant. Similarly, the fusion of sagittal suture is indicative of about 35 years of age. However, we can will also get the information like the sphenoparietal suture, they begin to close about 30 years, but it is not usually completely close until about 70 years. So there is it's not just one suture. We have to use the information of the several other feature to give us a approximate value about the age of the suture, age of the skull. Similarly, estimation of age from the ossification in the epiphyseal and their fusion with diaphyseal. An estimation of age can also be possible by analyzing the time of appearance of ossification in the epiphyseal region and their fusion with diaphyseal of the bone. For example, appearance of ossification at the capitulum of humerus, distal radius, distal tibia and fibula indicate 1 year of age in both sexes. At about 21 years of age, ossification appears at the medial end of clavicle in both sexes. Fusion of epiphyses of great tubercle of the head of humerus indicates about 4 years of age in female and about 5 years of age in male. Fusion of epiphyses of the distal phalanges of second, third and fourth toes indicates about 15 years of age in both sexes. Now let's try to estimate of age from the pubic symphysis. The morphological changes of the pubic symphysis are considered one of the most reliable estimator of age at death. For example, in post-adolescent and early adult life, the subpubic, sub-epiphyseal symphysis face present a transverse billowed or wavy surface with an increasing sharp dorsal margin and a bevelled ventral area. In the later part of the third decade, the billowed texture is lost and a typical overt symphyseal face result. Toward the end of the fifth decade, a narrow-headed rim developed on the margin. During the sixth decade, erosion of surface and breakdown of ventral margin begin to modify the configuration of the symphyseal face. Figure 3. It reflects the age changes in the pubic symphysis in adult white males. So the morphological changes of the pubic symphysis are considered one of the most reliable estimator of age at depth. For example, in the post-adolescent and early adult life, the sub-epiphyseal symphysial face present a transversely billowed or wavy surface with an increasing sharp dorsal margin of a bevelled ventral area. In the later part of the third decade, and below texture is lost and a typical overt symphyseal face result. Toward the end of the fifth decade, a narrow beaded rim developed on the margin. During the sixth decade, erosion of surface and breakdown of ventral margin begin to modify the configuration of the symphyseal face. Now let's try to estimate the age of the person or the age of the skeletal material that we recovered from teeth. An examination of the state of eruption of the teeth in infant will offer a reliable indicator of age in most cases, since the respective period of eruption of the different teeth are fairly constant. Approximate period at which the different temporal and permanent teeth appear, we can now try to find out that one. First, the temporal or deciduous teeth. Estimation of age from temporal teeth. If the period is 7 to 9 months, there is a appearance of eruption of first central incision take place. Similarly, if the period is about 6 to 8 months, we have seen the appearance of lower central incisor. As the time proceeds, when the child becomes 9 to 10 months old, there is an appearance of lateral incisor, and it continued till 18th month. At the age of 18th month, we have seen the appearance of first canine. Before that, about 12 months, the appearance of first molar teeth is also observed, and at the end of about 2 years, the second molar erupt. Okay, now let's try to estimate the age from permanent teeth. As we have seen in the earlier case, periodically there is eruption of teeth take place, and so over here also we have seen the similar sequencing evolution of the teeth also. Now let's try to estimate the age from permanent teeth. So the first central incisor, it erupted at the age of 7th year. But when the child become about 8th year, we have seen the development of lateral incisor, and it continued till the age of 11th year. In the 11th year, we have seen the development of second canine. Before that, during 9th year itself, the first premolar erupted, and at 10th year, the second premolar erupted, and at the time of 6th year, the first molar erupted. At the age of 12th year, the second molar eruption takes place. And the third molar, which is altogether called as rudimentary wisdom, or sometimes it is a non-functional teeth, start at the age of from the age of 17 to continue till up to 21st year or later, called as third molar. Blood as a forensic evidence. Now let's try to discuss how blood act as a forensic evidence and what is the role played by blood as far as the criminal investigation concerned. In crime of evidence or in crime of violence, body fluids are routine encountered as a vital or viral evidence. Blood is the most common form of biological material that is recovered from crime scene, even though along with other evidences. Blood stain analysis may be used to place a person at a crime scene or possibly to completely exclude that person. Now the important question arises over here, is the blood is of human being or some other group? Is the sample is of blood or some other things? So there are many stains such as rust, paint, wine, etc. which may look like a blood. So thus chemical tests are essential to confirm whether the sample is of blood or not. First test is called presumptive test. Presumptive tests are generally used at the crime scene and merely confirm that the substance is in question is most likely is a blood. For example, phenyloptin test. At first, a clean cotton swept deep in distilled water and then rubbed on the suspected stain. A drop of phenolphthalein solution is then added to the swept tip. A drop of hydrogen peroxide is then added. If the tip turns pink, the test is presumably positive for blood. Luminol test. Luminol is sprayed in crime scene which react in the presence of hemoglobin. When an oxidizer is applied, the reaction however result in a blue-white to yellow-green luminescence. The light emitted as a byproduct of a chemical reaction if blood is present. Confirmatory test for blood. Takayama test or hemochromogen test. The commonly used confirmatory test for blood is the Takayama test or hemochromogen test. In this test, a small sample of the presumptive stain is placed under a cover slip and heated lightly. Then pyridine under alkaline condition in the presence of a reducing sugar is added with a pipette in it. If blood is present, salmon colored crystal will form and can be viewed through a microscope. Let's try to find out if the sample is of human blood or not. There are a number of tests that can be used to identify human blood. For example, immunohematology, electrophoresis, and molecular marker. In the case of immunohematology, antigen antibody agglutination test or precipitation test was performed. In the case of electrophoresis, for identification of red cell enzymes and serum protein is used. In the case of molecular marker, most stable DNA isolation and test for humankind, RFLPs, were used. Stop. Let's try to find out what is the sex. The presence of drumstick in WBC white blood cells indicate female sex and its absence indicate male sex. The given figure over there, we can see the presence of a drumstick in WBC. So we can say that this figure will surely indicate indication of the female sex. So the presence or absence of drumstick act as a marker for giving the answer of what is sex. Like presence of drumstick in WBC is indication of female sex, and if there is a not, this drumstick is absent, it's altogether is not present over there, we can call it as it belongs to male. Now let's discuss about the important genetic markers in the blood. As we all know that blood possesses a number of genetic markers both in cell and serum, including ABO blood group, Rh factors, MNS, PGM and HP, etc. This is also used for personal identification. So whenever you find some materials related to blood, it may also act as an important factor or important material for personal identification, because it is always specific in nature and it contains number of markers that we have discussed about this. Just now I gave you a glimpse of information about this thing. Similarly, DNA from blood may also be used for personal identification. Once it was confirmed as human blood, DNA can be extracted from WBC for DNA profiling and for personal identification. It details with we can discuss about these things in such a manner that the material or DNA or the blood, the single material itself will act as a enough to give us a complete picture if we get the idea, if we get the material in the specialized or in a pure format or in a good conditions. So we can extract not only marker, we can extract the DNA also, and from the DNA we can clearly get the sequencing, patterning and organizes or arrangement of different nucleotides and nucleotides and nitrogen bases. Based on that, we can clearly explain, clearly find out, clearly give a clue related to personal identification. So DNA from bloods are also act as an important feature for personal identification of the person. Blood stain pattern analysis. Often found at the scene of violent crime, the analysis of blood stain can provide vital clue as to the occurrence of event. For example, venous blood will show fine droplets with striking surface, right angle star-like. Artery blood generally will show oblique pattern due to pressure. We can clearly see from the given figure, which shows how blood stain pattern analysis work. The diameter of the blood stain increases as the height increases. Finger as a forensic evidence. Fingerprints have long been considered as the backbone of forensic identification, even in the age of DNA technology. This is because of the fact that fingerprints are matchless to the individual, and thus assume that a match between a suspect print and an evaluating print is sufficient to individualize the evidence and link it to the common sources. Classification of fingerprint pattern. There are four types of fingerprint pattern, namely arch, loop, whorl and composite. The arch are either plain arch or tented arch. Loops are further subdivided into two types depending on their opening as ulnar loop and radial loop. Whorl are also further subdivided into plain whorl, central pocket loop, double loop and accidental. We can see the figure of a fingerprint pattern from left arch loop whorl. At the lower side, we can find out some information about minutiae. Along with fingerprint pattern, the ridge of each fingerprint also contain unique feature which allow them for personal identification. These rich characteristics are collectively known as minutiae. This include the pattern of the pores on fingerprint, bifurcation, island, short ridge, termination, enclosure, etc. Now let's discuss about the types of fingerprint that generally are commonly found in crime scene. There are three important types of fingerprints which are commonly observed or found in a crime scene, that is visible, plastic and latin. Visual prints are those print which is clearly visible and it does not require any processing and can be found on substances such as paint or blood. Whereas the plastics is another types of fingerprint which is also clearly visible, but it does not require processing and can be found on soft surfaces such as tar and some of the things where we need a special reflecting angle to see that one. Third type is latent one. As we have seen that in the case of visible one, it is clearly visible, but in the case of latent, it is not clearly visible to the naked eye. It required treatment to make it in a visible form and can be found for example on human skins or at several places of the crime scene or at many places, which is not at all exactly can be visualized, which is not at all seen in a normalized fashion. For that we need a special treatment to make it visualized. Latent fingerprints. A latent fingerprint is one left on an object surface when it is touched. The oldest and still most common method to make visible latent fingerprint is to use fingerprint powder of a contrasting color by a soft fiberglass brush to create contrast between the ridge pattern and the background. Once a latent print becomes visible, it is photographed and developed on specific surface. So latent print, here we can see a use of fine powder to reveal latent fingerprint and paper treated with ninhydrin reagent to show the latent fingerprint from the side. See the figure reflect the latent print. From the left side of the figure we can say that first one indicating the use of powder to reveal latent fingerprints. Second one is paper treated with ninhydrin. Third one is the site treated with a fluorescent dye. So the latent fingerprint is one that is not at all visible and that is left on the surface when it is touched. Even though till today mostly people they are using the most common method to make this invisible print visible, they use a fingerprint powder of a contrasting color by a soft fiberglass brush to create contrast between the ridge pattern and the background. A number of chemical methods are available for the visualization of latent print for example, ninhydrin, iodine. Ninhydrin is used to develop latent print, that is of purple color, on porous surface like paper by reacting with amino acid in latent print residue. Iodine. Fumes from iodine crystal develop latent prints on surface that are impractical for traditional dusting or have residues such as grease. The print developed are visible only for few hours and then become faded. So it should be photographed immediately once observable. Now let's discuss about collection of fingerprint from a crime scene. See the figure that indicate the use of lifting tape to lift fingerprint. This is one of the method of collecting fingerprint. Fingerprint that are generally visible can be photographed and the print can be used for comparison. However, for latent fingerprint, photograph can be taken only after it become visible by practical or chemical treatment. Sometime it is possible to lift the latent fingerprint. This can be done by placing a lifting tape on the fingerprint. The lifting paper is then placed on the latent lift card to preserve the print. Comparison of fingerprint for personal identification. The comparison of fingerprint collection collected from the suspect and from the crime scene for identification is not only made by comparing the pattern or by merely the presence or absence of minutiae, but is done by comparing the presence, kind, number, and especially the arrangement of the pattern and minutiae characteristics that create a unique pattern. Nowadays, this comparison can be done by automated fingerprint identification system called AFIS. This AFIS is a computer programming which digitized the image of a fingerprint and then encode the detail of the minutiae for searching in the database. This system does not identify a person uniquely, but rather provide a list of potential match for the fingerprint examiner to evaluate and make the final determination. This figure shows the comparison of minutiae. The minutiae that was discovered are collected from the suspect and from the scene of the fingerprint for identification purpose. And is not only made by comparing, this identification of the fingerprint is not only made by comparing the pattern or by merely the presence or absence of minutiae, but it is also done by comparing the presence or kind, number, and especially the arrangement of the pattern and minutiae characteristic that create a unique pattern. Each pattern has a specific arrangement of a pattern. Based on the comparison of this pattern and also the number of this pattern or the kind of pattern or the arrangement of this minutiae, we can make the comparison of the fingerprint for personal identification purposes. DNA as forensic evidence. The development and application of human genetics has reformed forensic anthropology in the last two decades. Nowadays, DNA profile makes it possible to associate a DNA sample to a specific person with a high degree of confidence and thus providing a new powerful identification tool that supplement fingerprints and other method of identification to the forensic investigation. There are two type of DNA, namely the nuclear DNA, which is located in the nucleus, and mitochondrial DNA, which is located in the mitochondria. However, both, that is nuclear DNA and mitochondrial DNA, both are used for DNA profiling in personal identification. Now let's discuss about the sources of DNA. What are the sources of DNA? DNA or deoxyribonucleic acid sample can be obtained from a number of biological material including saliva, tissue, blood, hair follicle, semen, bone, and from a scene of crime. When we discuss about the nuclear DNA, the human nuclear DNA contains approximately 3.2 billion base pair, and it organized into 23 pair of chromosomes, in fact. A large number of this DNA is similar and is required for the protein synthesis. However, there are segments of DNA that vary from one person to another and are called as hypervariable region. These regions are commonly used as a marker for personal identifications. There are several techniques that make DNA typing possible for forensic investigation or forensic identification, like RFLP, that is restriction fragment length polymorphism. There are several techniques that make DNA typing possible for forensic identification, like RFLP, that is restriction fragment length polymorphism. As DNA can be obtained from a number of biological material including saliva, tissue, blood, hair follicle, semen, bone, and from a scene of crime, this particular element, here we can see the figure of the nuclear DNA. It has a base pair, it has a sugar phosphate backbone. Here we will see the nitrogen bases of adenine, and that is a purine and pyrimidine, like adenine, thymine, guanine, cytosine, their arrangement, this nuclear DNA also act as a material for identification of a person. Restriction fragment length polymorphism, RFLP. In RFLP analysis, a restriction enzyme is used to cut the DNA sample into number of pieces of variable size. The number and the size of the DNA fragment depend on the variation in the number of time a sequence of base pair in the DNA is repeated. From a forensic anthropological viewpoint, these fragments are extremely polymorphic since the number of repeat sequence varies from person to person. Because the polymorphism comes from the number of repeat, this kind of DNA typing is categorized as VNTR, that is variable number of tandem repeat. These are length polymorphisms with a core sequence are between 10 and 100 base pair in length and in one person. This sequence may be repeated as a given T times on a given chromosome, while in another person it may repeat 10 times. In forensic science, 4 to 6 of these highly polymorphic VNTR loci are analyzed. The results are used to generate DNA profiles for comparison and personal identification. Visualization of VNTRs. The technique by which these VNTRs can be identified is called Southern blotting electrophoresis. In order to visualize the VNTR, the DNA fragments are located into a well at the base of a slab of electrophoresis gel. An electrical current is then applied which separates the VNTR's base based on length and charge of DNA fragment. After that, the DNA fragments are stained with radioactive single-strand DNA sequence for visualization and identification. There are two figures. One indicates the VNTR loci and other indicates the VNTR alleles. This is a VNTR is visualization or visualized by a technique by which these VNTRs can be identified, and it is also called as a Southern blotting electrophoresis. In order to visualize the VNTR, the DNA fragments are located into a well at the base of a slab of electrophoresis gel. An electrical current is then applied, which separates the VNTR's base on length and charge of DNA fragment. After that, the DNA fragments are stained with radioactive single-strand DNA sequence for visualization and identification. PCR or polymerase chain reaction. RFLP gives good result when there is a large amount of high-quality DNA. But the DNA sample come from a crime scene may not be large in amount, and more frequently they are too fragmented to be useful. In this situation, PCR technique is used primarily to increase the amount of DNA by amplification. PCR is based on a natural process of DNA replication. PCR uses DNA polymerase to rapidly replicate a specific DNA sequence millions of times. Short tandem repeats, STRs. STRs are currently the most commonly analyzed genetic polymorphisms in forensic genetics. There are thousands of STRs that can potentially be used for forensic analysis. STR loci are spread throughout the genome, including both autosome and sex chromosome. STRs have a core unit of between 2 and 6 base pair, and the repeats typically range from 50 to 300 base pair. STR have great advantage over VNTRs, which make STR more attractive for forensic comparison purposes. For example, STR markers have greater variability in a population, thus giving rise to high degree of association of evidence with a suspect. There are many STRs to choose from the forensic purposes. Moreover, STRs are very less sensitive to degeneration of the DNA due to their smaller repeat size. Similar to that of VNTRs, STRs are also identified by electrophoresis, and the results are then used to generate DNA profiles for comparison and personal identification. Identification of sex from DNA. There are two approaches to sex identification from a DNA sample. First, amelogenin, and second, YSTRs. First, let's discuss about amelogenin. In the case of amelogenin, there is a presence of one electrophoresis band for amelogenin locus indicate female sex, and presence of two electrophoresis band for amelogenin locus indicate male sex. Whereas in the case of YSTR, the presence of YSTR, a sex specific DNA marker, indicates male sex, and its absence indicate female sex. Mitochondrial DNA or mtDNA. Mitochondrial DNA located in mitochondria and inherited maternally. The human mitochondrial DNA is a circular molecule and consisting of 16,569 nucleotides. There are a number of situations where mitochondrial DNA becomes a valuable genetic marker. For example, it is very helpful when the amount of cellular material available for analysis is very small, or if the source does not contain nucleated cell. Moreover, mitochondrial DNA is also advantageous for the study of highly degraded human remains where standard STR typing is not possible. Due to its maternal inheritance, mitochondrial DNA is very useful for personal identification of a missing person or person in mass disaster, especially when there are no direct relatives to use as a reference sample. Because all maternal relatives share the same type of mitochondrial DNA. Analysis of mitochondrial DNA is generally performed by comparing the sequence of its hypervariable region. Figure of mitochondrial DNA. This mitochondrial DNA were inherited from mainly from the mother line only or maternal line only. And they are consisting of about more than 16,000 nucleotides. They are mostly situated in the where mitochondria becomes a very valuable genetic marker. There are a number of situations where it acts as a very, very important marker. Like when the amount of cellular material available for analysis is either very trivial or very small. Moreover, mitochondrial DNA is also advantageous for the study of highly degraded human remains where standard STR typing is not possible. It has a number of loops called as D loop, heavy strand, light strand, ND4, ND4L, then ND3, it has a skull, ND2, then rRNA regions, there is a rRNA region of 16S and 12S, and so on. Interpretation of DNA profile. Once it has been established that the two DNA profile are the same, the significance of the match has to be estimated. This significance of the match or the probability is calculated by the frequencies of each allele using pollution database and indicate the probability of a chance occurrence of a given DNA profile within a chosen population. Thus, in order to reduce the chance occurrence of similar DNA profile, forensic experts are commonly use multi-locus genotype using large number of STR loci for identification. Because this multi-locus genotype becomes so rare that it is improbable that two types in the world would have the same exact type. This helped the forensic expert to conclude in DNA profile cases that the match of the DNA type from the evidence and the suspect can be used for identification, except in the case of identical twins. So, my dear student, let's try to give you once again the try to summarize the complete modules with some of the important points that we have learned, or some of the point which act as a highlighting point of this particular modules. Like, forensic anthropology is the application of knowledge and technique of physical anthropology to study the questions of medico-legal importance. Means, we are using the knowledge of anthropology, especially physical anthropology, for legal purposes in order to providing much more authentic scientific explanation to the legal cases. There are different types of evidences, including skeleton, body fluid like blood, fingerprint, etc., that can be found in a scene, crime scene, and are used by forensic anthropology for personal identification. It is easy to identify a skull, but unless and until we find a complete skull, it is very difficult to identify them. For that, we need a knowledge of anatomy. For that, we need a knowledge of comparative anatomy. For that, we need a knowledge of a vertebral evolution based anatomical knowledge, like bone as a part of a complete skeleton or individual, whether the bone that was recovered, it belongs to one person or more than one person, or whether it belongs to man or any other animals. We have to see the things in such a fashion that it become problematic, it become altogether very clear. If the bone is fragmented or not in a pure format, then it's really very difficult to get the clear cut picture of it. So unlike rigidity, unlike identifying features, it is important to have a clear cut knowledge about this thing. In different bones, and especially for fragmented bones, the key questions arises over here is that whether the bone belongs to human being or not. First important, before that, it is important to know that whether it is a bone or not, whether it is some plastic animals, maybe because of it is fossilization, it may be accumulation of minerals. So it is very important for us to know the answer of this particular question, whether it is a bone or not. Next important question is that the forensic anthropologist tried to answer how many persons were involved and whether it is a human being or not. Are the bones of male or female? That is about the sex. Next important question is related to the age. What was the age of the person at the time of death? And similarly, we try to find out the answer of the other answer of any other questions that will give you some more informations for coming with some clear picture about the individual, that whose skeletal material or whose body or parts of the body that recovered from the sites of the scene or from any mass destruction areas. That's it. What is the race? And so many, there are many questions related to that. The answer of these questions are very important because this will lead to personal identifications of the remains and possibly to determine the cause and manners of death. Thank you.